got two choirs up here tonight, amen? And I'm telling you, I'm excited about hearing both of them sing tonight. And so we're going to pray, and then we're just going to get started. How about that? Let's have church tonight. I want us just to have church tonight. I'm so glad that you're here, and you be praying for the service and pray for these kids. They're going to sing a couple songs right off the bat. Okay, let's pray. Father, we give you praise and thanks for what you've done in our lives. And Lord, we just want to praise you tonight. We desire to lift your name up above every name. Lord, we know that there's coming a day that everybody in here is going to bow before you. And Lord, I'm thankful for the opportunity that we can bow before you now as our Lord and our Savior. And I pray that everybody that is in this building tonight, before they leave, everyone here will know that they have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Bless this service, Lord. Bless us with your outpouring of your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
There's revival, and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear?
Cause Thank you, kiddos, and welcome to the church tonight. Let's stand together. We're going to sing a medley of songs tonight, beginning with There's Power in the Blood. Let's sing together. Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power. They changed that song. Somebody tell me where they changed it. Such a worm as I. That's the way I grew up, and that's the way it's supposed to be sung. We're going to sing it again. Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign I receive my
last song. Oh, how he loves you and me. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us the way you do. So the offerings this week are going towards Brother Bob's ministry. And so I encourage you to give as you have been blessed. I know it's hard to kind of figure that out, but the best way you do that is pray. And you say, God, what do you want me to do? And God may surprise you about what he wants you to do. But he has been such a tremendous blessing to us. Amen. That we get to invest in his ministry. And so I encourage you to give as the Lord leads you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Wes, would you lead us?
Left behind heaven's throne to wield it here. Choir and Katie, as they come down, let's just sing this chorus. Sovereign Lord. Sing it with me. Sovereign Lord, Sovereign Lord, we exalt your holy name, Sovereign Lord, Creator, Redeemer, the King.
By two choirs tonight. Amen. What a great, great time we've had already tonight. Now we get to fellowship around the Word. We've been fellowshipping in praise. Now we fellowship around the Word. So get your copy of the Word of God out, whether it's your Bible or your phone. I know it took me a long time to get used to that, Brother Bob. But if they looking on their phone and not texting, if they got the Bible on it, good. Brother, come and preach the word for us. Thank you so much, Brother Bob Pittman.
Thank you, Pastor. Let me turn myself on. Amen. Thank you. I believe preachers ought to be turned on, don't you? Well, what another night of wonderful music. You know, I'm in churches that have larger choirs, but I'm in no church that has as good a choir as you have here. And these three musicians, my goodness, they are absolutely the best. I don't know if you pay them or not, but it's not enough. They're really, really good. And thank you, Brother Larry. I always love the music you select. I love the way they do it. And fellas and girls, you blessed me tonight. Amen. That was wonderful, wonderful. Well, take your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 18. Now, I've been preaching for 60 years. I've been in over a thousand revival meetings. And in most revivals, they have special emphasis nights. They'll have a men's night, a ladies' night. They'll have an old people's night, a children's night, people who have distemper night. I mean, they have all kind of stuff. And I usually don't address those themes. Those are just sort of themes to get people to come, and I appreciate that effort, but I usually just go ahead and preach, so you know, differently than the night of the theme. But God's been dealing with my heart about tonight. I knew there were going to be some children here, and they were going to have a time before the service and then sing during the service. And I was reading through the 18th, through the Gospel of Matthew and this afternoon, and I came through the 18th chapter, and God began to deal with my heart. So I'm going to preach a new sermon tonight, and I do that at least once a month, but I used to take a little more time to get ready for it than just an afternoon. And so the only danger about preaching a new sermon is, number one, you don't know if it's going to fly or not, and number two, you don't have any idea how long or short it's going to be. And to even make it worse, I forgot my watch. I left it at the motel. Now, if I were to ask, I'd probably get 50 offers right here. But keep your watch on. I won't preach long. I want to get into the invitation tonight. And I'm praying that some boys and girls will get saved. But now listen, boys and girls are not the only ones that need to get saved. So mamas and daddies can get saved tonight too. Matthew chapter 18, beginning in verse 1. If you found it, say amen. At the same time, at the very moment, at the same time, came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And Jesus called a little child unto him and set him in the midst of them, and said, "Verily I say unto you, except you be converted and become as little children, you shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoso shall receive one such little child in my name receiveth me. But whoso shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me, it were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck, and that he were drowned in the depth of the sea." verse 1 says, at the same time, at the very moment. Now, chapter 17 ends with Jesus talking about paying taxes. Most people are not real interested in that. Neither were the disciples. I mean, they listened to him, they paid attention to him, but that really wasn't what was on their mind. As soon as he finished his talk on taxes, they opened up and expressed to him exactly what was on their mind. They said, Jesus, we want to know right now, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Now, folks, this was not the first time it has come up. This had been whispered among themselves for a while. You think it might be him? You think it might be him? Could it be him? You think it might be me? Who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Isn't that just like a bunch of adults to talk like that? Interestingly enough, Jesus did not rebuke them and he did not fuss at them. He answered them. And he answered them in two ways. He gave them a visual answer. And he gave them a verbal answer. Who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And they were all standing there around him wanting to hear. And there was a little boy over here. A little child, the Bible says. I don't know, he's not an infant. But he wasn't very old, just a little boy. And Jesus called him to come. And the little boy came. And Jesus held him up in his arms and... You want to know who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Well, here he is. Now, this little boy had never been to seminary. This little boy had never performed a miracle. This little boy had never preached a sermon. And Jesus said, here he is. It was a visual answer. And then Jesus said, except you become as a child like this one, you're not going to be great in the kingdom of heaven. And so that's what this passage of Scripture, how it is set in the New Testament, dealing with how to be great in the kingdom of heaven. But there's an underlying theme here that I want to look at from these verses. And I want to share with you some reasons why I believe boys and girls can be saved. I'm going to work through this very quickly, and then we'll have our invitation. Now remember, Jesus said at the end of these verses, rather than being a stumbling block to a child, it would be better if you took a millstone. Now millstones weighed from 700 pounds up to 2,000 pounds. It would be better for you to take a millstone, tie it around your neck, and throw the millstone into the depths of the sea. And friend, wherever the millstone goes, thou goest too. It's the only time Jesus ever recommended suicide. Jesus said it would be better for you to take your own life than to be a stumbling block for children coming to him. My. I've seen mothers and dads, when their children begin to step out into the aisle, I've seen mothers and dads reach and pull them back. Oh, don't do that. Oh, you'll have a lifetime of regret maybe if you do that. Don't ever do that. I tell you what mother and dads ought to do. They ought to say, would you like me to walk down that aisle with you? That's what you ought to say. So why I believe boys and girls can be saved. Number one, I believe boys and girls can be saved because they can respond to the call of Jesus. Now look there with me, if you will, in verse 2. And Jesus called a little child unto him. That word called is an interesting word. It means to invite. Jesus invited this little boy. I don't know who this little boy was. I don't know if he was there by himself or if the other people were with him. I don't know what he was doing there. But he was there. And Jesus called him. He invited him to come to him. And this little boy stood up and went over to be with Jesus. You see, boys and girls can respond to the call of Jesus. How does Jesus call people unto himself? Well, he does it in many ways. Sometimes he'll do it through the voice of a mother or a dad. Sometimes he will do it through the voice of a Sunday school teacher. Sometimes he will do it through the words of a song. Sometimes he will do it through the voice of a pastor or an evangelist. But Jesus still invites people to come to him. And little boys and little girls, they may not be educated as much as they're going to be. They may not know all there is to know about science and biology and all that stuff. But I'm telling you, boys and girls can respond to the call of Jesus. They can come. And boys and girls, you don't have to have anybody's permission to come to Jesus. I mean, if he's calling you, then you need to come. Your mom and dad may come with you, they may not, but you just need to come on if you hear his voice. And he doesn't just scream out loud. He speaks to your heart very quietly and very softly. And yet you know there's something going on inside of you. There's that voice, there's that tender, sweet spirit that's saying, tonight is your night. This is your time. It's time for you to give your heart to Jesus. And when you feel that in your life, that's God speaking to you. That's Jesus calling you, and you can respond. Boys and girls can be saved because they can respond to the call of Jesus. Number two, boys and girls can be saved because they can surrender to the will of Jesus. Now look there in verse 2 again. Jesus called a little child unto him, and notice this, and set him in the midst of them. Now, there are three Gospels that talk about this very thing, this same incident. The Gospel of Matthew here says that the little boy comes and he stands in the midst. In other words, he's standing in front of Jesus. The disciples are here in front, sort of in a semicircle perhaps, and Jesus puts him right there in front of himself to look at all these disciples. The Gospel of Luke tells us that this little boy comes and he stands beside Jesus. The Gospel of Mark tells us that this little boy comes and Jesus reaches down with his arms and picks him up. So, Brother Bob, which is it? Did this little boy come and stand beside Jesus? Or did he come and stand in front of Jesus? Or did he get lifted up in the arms of Jesus? Well, the answer is yes. All three of them happened. When Jesus called this little boy responded to the call of Jesus, and he came and he stood by the Lord. And when Jesus moved him around in front of him, that little boy didn't resist. He didn't fuss. He didn't try to run. Wherever Jesus put him, he did it. And when Jesus reached down and picked him up in his arms, this little boy was just fine. There was no struggle. There was no trying to get away. I'm telling you, boys and girls can surrender to the will of Jesus. They can respond to the call of Jesus, and they can surrender to the will of Jesus. And those are the first two steps in coming to Christ for salvation. You respond to his call, you surrender to his will. But there's a third reason here why I believe it. They're already childlike. Look there with me in verse 3. He says, he's talking to these men, except you be converted and become as little children. Hey, a child does not have to become as a child. A child is already a child. Now listen, he did not say you must become childish. I know some adults that are pretty childish. Hey, that's a matter of fact, that's what these disciples were doing. They were saying, who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Who's the greatest? That's pretty childish if you want to know the truth about it. My wife and I, we have 7 grandchildren, and I'm not going to bore you with somebody said, have I shown you the pictures of my grandchildren? And I said, no, and thank you very much for that. But we have 7 grandchildren, and one of our grandchildren named Noah, when he was a little boy, he used to come, loved to come to our house, and my wife has this great big walk-in closet full of all kind of children's toys. They're still there, every one of them, but the grandchildren, they've kind of outgrown that. But when he was a little fella, he loved to come, and he would go in that closet, and he would stay in there for, I mean, a long, long time and decide what he wanted to play, and he was a sweet boy, Noah was. He just graduated last year from high school. He's in college now. And Noah was a nice, sweet-spirited little guy. But sometimes he'd do something I didn't like, or sometimes he'd do something his grandmother didn't like. And I would say, or she would say, Noah, stop that. And boy, I tell you, his head would drop His arms would fold, that bottom lip would stick out, and he'd stand there for about 5 minutes and pout. Now, you know, to be very honest, there's something a little bit cute about a 5-year-old boy pouting. But there ain't nothing cute about a 40-year-old deacon pouting. And there's nothing cute about a 40-year-old woman pouting either. And so Jesus does not say to these men, you have to be childish. He says you have to be childlike. Now, that doesn't mean you have to be a child to get saved. These men were not saved as children. When those disciples were little boys and little boys, well, they never heard about Jesus. I mean, they never even thought one thing. They never even heard his name when they were children. And so these were all saved as adults. But Jesus said, in order to be saved, you've got to become like a child. You've got to think like a child and develop a heart like a child. What is the heart of a child? Well, children, they're tenderhearted. You know, I can have a 4-year-old, a 5-year-old, 6-year-old boy or 6-year-old girl come up into my presence and I can say, honey, do you know Jesus loves you and that he died on the cross to save you? And their little old eyes will puddle up and their lips will begin to quiver. You know why? They're tenderhearted. Now, I can tell a 50-year-old man, sir, Jesus loves you and he died on the cross to save you, and his eyes are not going to puddle up and his lips are not going to quiver. Because you see, the older you get, the harder your heart becomes. Life has a strange way of hardening our hearts. But boys and girls are tenderhearted. I tell you something else about the nature of a child is they're truthful. They'll tell the truth. I pastored 3 churches in my ministry early on, and in all 3 of the churches, we would ordain men as deacons, and we always had a committee of deacons, and they would go, and they would investigate. They would talk to the deacon and ask him all kinds of questions. I never did that. I went to the deacon's children, because deacon's children, all children, are very truthful. The committee would say, do you have family devotions in your home? Oh, yes, we do. I'd ask that little 5-year-old son, hey, do y'all have revival reading and prayer at your house? No, we don't ever do that. You see, they're just truthful. I don't like my teacher. Why don't you like her? She's fat. You know? I don't like my teacher. Why? She's ugly. They're just truthful. Now, we would never say that. I mean, I might look at you and say, man, you have a face that would make time stand still. And what that means is you're ugly enough, stop a clock, you see? But little boys and girls, they're just truthful. They'll tell the truth. And I tell you something else, they're trusting. I mean, if you tell them something, usually they'll just believe you. That's just the nature of a child. And children don't have to become like that. They're already like that. And since they're already like you have to be to become a Christian, I believe boys and girls can be saved. But a 4th reason I believe boys and girls can be saved is because they're humble. Jesus said, humble yourself even as this child. Do you know why a lot of people go to hell? They go to hell because of pride. I mean, pride just sends life. Well, I can't become a Christian, man. I'm a pillar in the community. Everybody knows me. They all look up to me. They think I'm somebody. And if I get saved, they'll think there's something wrong with me. Hey, there is. You're lost. And you need Jesus. You need Jesus. Wouldn't it be wonderful if everybody in Washington, D.C. was a born-again child of God? Oh, I tell you, we need that pretty bad right now. You'd have a hard time building a Sunday school class out of that crowd up there. I'm just being honest now. We need some godly people. But boys and girls are humble. They're not a little old boy come in from playing, half snot dripping down his nose. Doesn't bother him one bit. Mama's pass out, but it doesn't bother the kid. He'll come in with his hands just black with dirt all over them. They've been doing all kinds of stuff, and he's ready to go sit down at the dinner table. He don't mind eating with dirty hands. There's no pride there, you see. Boys and girls, they're not into that stuff. They don't have to humble themselves. They don't have to make themselves lowly. That's what it means to be humble. They're already there. That's just their very nature. So boys and girls can be saved because they can respond to the call of Jesus. They can be saved because they can surrender to the will of Jesus. They can be saved because they're already childlike in their being. And boys and girls can be saved because they're humble in their spirit. But fifthly, boys and girls can be saved because they can believe in Jesus. Look what he says there in verse 6. But whoso shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me. Listen, Jesus said boys and girls can believe in him. That's what he said. Which believe in me. Do boys and girls know all 66 books of the Bible? I doubt your deacons do either. I know a lot of preachers that don't know that. Well, I know there's an Old Testament and a New Testament. Well, that's good. That'd give you an F plus on a test. Boys and girls don't have to go through a catechism. They don't have to know everything there is in the Bible. They don't have to be able to turn to the book of Nahum in 5 seconds. If I were to ask you to turn to the book of Nahum, I'd be back at the motel before some of you found it. But I'm telling you, boys and girls can believe in Jesus. And that's not what I said. That's what Jesus said. Boys and girls can believe in Jesus. I've seen boys and girls come, and I never manipulate children. I've never done that. I'm not going to do that. I don't put pressure on boys and girls. Usually, I don't even preach a children's sermon on children's night. But tonight, God wouldn't let me get away from this. But I want to tell you, boys and girls can believe in Jesus. They can believe in Jesus. We don't have to manipulate them. We don't have to trick them. Just tell them, hey, Jesus wants you to come to him. He's inviting you to come. And you can respond to him. You can surrender to his will. You are a child, and that's the way he wants you to come. And you're humble in spirit. And if you'll believe in him, he'll save you. He'll save you. He'll save you. I've seen lots of boys and girls get saved in revival meetings. And every time you can kind of look around the congregation, and there'll be a few there. Yeah, there'll be a few. You can just watch them. They begin to tilt their head back and look down their nose and see those children. Well, they're not old enough to know what they're doing. Who made you the high sheriff of the universe? Listen, when it comes time for people to walk down the aisle, that's God's business, and you'd best stay out of God's business. Did you know God is really good at what he does? I mean, really, he is. He never has to have any counsel. He doesn't have to take any seminars. He doesn't have to have any refreshing courses. He's very good at being God. Just let him do his thing, all right? So we come now to an invitation. Brother Bobby didn't preach long, didn't plan to. I believe there are some boys and girls that were saved out there a while ago in the 5:30 meeting. You saw that video. And then Brother Wilton talked to you about giving your heart to Jesus. I think some of you there asked Jesus to come into your heart. Now, Jesus never wants us to be ashamed of him. If you've given your heart to Jesus, you don't have to be ashamed. And so if you gave your heart to Jesus out there, when we stand, I'm going to ask you to come and take the pastor by the hand and come and stand beside him. And he'll know why you're coming. Pastor, I gave my heart to Jesus out there in the earlier time. And then there may be some of you here tonight, you didn't give your heart to Jesus back there because maybe you weren't real sure you could. But I'm telling you, you can. And if you'll come to Jesus tonight, You can respond to his invitation, and Jesus is calling you right now. There's something going on in some of your hearts, and you know it is. There's something stirring on the inside of you, and that's the voice of God. That's Jesus calling you, and you can respond. You can come to him, and you can surrender to him and ask him to come into your life, and he will. Now, Father, I've been very obedient tonight. If I've ever been obedient, it's been tonight. Lord, I have preached what you put on my heart this afternoon. Lord, I thank you that boys and girls can be saved. And Lord, I thank you that you will never turn a single one of them away. If they will just come to you, you'll save them. And so, Lord, tonight during this invitation, I pray that no boy or girl would leave here without Christ. And Lord, there are some teenagers here. Lord, many of them are already saved, but some of them are not. And they need to be saved. And I pray they would not let this message, especially designed for children, be offensive to them. Lord, if they're not saved, I pray they'd come. Lord, there's some mamas and daddies here tonight who need to get saved. Lord, there's some grandmas and grandpas. Man, they came out tonight to hear their grandchildren sing in church, and they know they've never even been saved. And God, would you save them tonight? Lord, thank you that whosoever will may come and take the water of life. Thank you that you so loved the world that you gave your only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God, save people tonight, and we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.